Set.
So away they go, the final of the men's T42 200 metres, and Whitehead gets the slow start, but he will surge through the field, and let's see how well he can go now. But on the inside, Scott Rubin for Australia has the lead, and it's Jackie O'Vance for the United States, but here he comes and hits the front. It's going to be a goal for Great Britain, and a wonderful run. He crosses the line in 24.39. It's a new world record, and Richard Whitehead, quite superb in the latter stages of that race, came storming through, and the crowd goes wild. Wonderful performance. He celebrates. He has conquered the world. He is the Paralympic champion.
And we have another rather exciting guest joining us on stage next. He's four times world champion and double Paralympic gold medalist, a world record holder over half and full marathon distances, and he's one of the most successful Paralympic sprinters of all times. In addition to his athletic achievements, he's also founded the Richard Whitehead Foundation, where he works in collaboration with Nissan to support and develop more opportunities for disabled people. So first, let's see another film.
When we believe anything is possible, our potential has no limits. We can conquer marathons against the greatest of odds. We can be exactly who we want to be, no matter how big the obstacles or how tough the fight. The future can be whatever we believe is possible. At Nissan, we're leading from the front to create a world with zero emissions and zero inequalities, using our technology, resources, and expertise to improve the lives of people from underrepresented communities, leaving nobody behind. Introducing the Nissan Possibilities Project.
So please give a warm welcome to Richard Whitehead.
Thank you. How's everybody going? It's good today, isn't it? It's nice to be out, nice to be able to communicate with people, not just over Zoom and Teams. Oh, I can run a marathon, but I can't even get on a stool.
Oh, I found it a challenge as well. It's so hard.
We have all those challenges, don't we? But thank you for, obviously, one, and let me have this opportunity to chat to you. It's great being back at the NEC. Also, it's great to be out. And I think one of the things that we've all missed, not as disabled people, but just people in general, is that opportunity to communicate with each other, right? And the disability community has so many barriers and obstacles anyway. That lack of contact makes a real difference. So it's great to be here, and great to be chatting about my story and my relationship with Nissan and the Possibilities Project that you just saw. And hopefully you'll have a look at the Nissan stall as well, and look at the new cars that are there at the moment for obviously the Motability, so the Leaf and the Aria. I'm actually an EV driver myself, and I see the benefits of that. So as you saw on the video, you saw my 200 meters event in London 2012. That was actually 10 years ago.
Oh my goodness.
So 10 years ago. It's crazy, isn't it, how the environment for people with disabilities has, in some cases, changed. And in other cases, we've still got a real long way to go. I think perceptions of people with disabilities in certain respects, the superheroes and kind of some other respects for disabled people, has massively changed. But we still got some of those economic, financial barriers for people with disabilities, as we know. Economically, being a disabled person, the cost of living is a lot higher. And those are things that people like myself, that has that platform to make that impact, we need to talk about that more, so that everybody has the opportunity to be not inspired by the Paralympics, because I don't like the word inspired, but have an impact on your lives. I think it's really important, because as a person with a disability, as a Paralympic athlete, we value you as spectators, administrators, officials, as highly as competitors as well. So I think it's really important. So when you're sitting listening or standing listening, that you feel valued and feel part of the journey. And like I say, 10 years, a lot has happened. I've chosen with, that's a bit of an annoying sound, isn't it?
I know, they'll hopefully turn it off soon.
Over the last 10 years, for me, I've made sure that when I put on that tracksuit, I've been able to like really embrace the power that being a Paralympic athlete gives you. And one of the things is that obviously I've now got my own foundation, the Richard Whitehead Foundation. And because I wanted to have that lasting legacy, it's not just about myself being a double leg amputee and a runner. It's a charity and a foundation that supports everybody in the disability community, which is really important. After London 2012, I had the opportunity to have a charity and a charitable organisation, but I've chosen the last 7, 8, 9 years to actually enrich my life so that I'm able to outreach not only to my community as runners, as amputees, but also those minority communities as well. Because as we know, there's lots of barriers and obstacles, not only just for disabled people, but there's people from other minority groups as well that have disabilities. So that intersectionality approach around inclusion is really important. And then going back to my relationship with Nissan, I'm actually their equality and diversity officer with Adele Roberts, the DJ from Radio 1. And our role and responsibility is obviously to promote EV, so electric vehicles, and also to go into those diverse minority groups and really promote the importance of the environment. And for me, being a Paralympic athlete, it's been really important to have a journey that's been enriching as well, and I've really grown since that point that you saw in 2012 where I crossed that finish line and showed you the guns are still there, I hope. And success isn't all about like self-gratification, it's not all about like medals, it's about memories, and hopefully I've given a lot of people memories of my success through my support. And I've shared obviously my medals and my medal success as well, and I think that's really important. So hence the reason why in June, on the 25th of June, if anybody's available in Nottingham, I've actually got a sponsored event. It's called Run With Rich, but we're encouraging everybody to come, whether you're in a power chair, whether you're walking, whether you're running or jogging, just to come down and take part in an event at Home Pier Pond. And you can actually, if you either collect one of the cards that's coming around now or look at the website and the Whitehead Foundation, you can enrol and come to that event in June. Also, we're looking for volunteers to get involved with the foundation as well, because that's something that's really important to me, that it's not all about the participation. As a person with a disability, we do find volunteering, employment and participation as a real issue. And those are the key areas that as a foundation that we're looking to have an impact on.
Brilliant, that sounds amazing.
I do like to chat a bit, sorry.
I'll definitely try and come along. My own kind of memory is, I mean, I lost my legs later in life, and I was actually told when I was in hospital, there's no point even trying to walk, you might as well just use a chair. And then someone actually showed me you, and I was like, well, he can like run, so if he can run, I'm sure I can walk a couple of steps, so.
And that's what's important, isn't it? It's important to have again, not role models, just see people that are doing incredible things within their life, and whether that's in sport, within entertainment, and in your community as well. I'm sure there's people that are here today that are here for the first time seeing people like themselves,
yeah,
and knowing that it's possible, which is really important. It's really important to see that the journey from where you're starting, there is hope and there is possibility, and the Paralympics gave me that kind of platform. And everybody in this room, everybody listening and watching, has got a gift, and it's about nurturing that gift. Having a disability or an impairment or a challenge or a barrier or an obstacle should be seen as a resource and not a hindrance. I feel that when I talk to brands and businesses, I always encourage them to look into the disability community, because we are resourceful, and through the challenges that we've had to overcome within our lives, we can offer business, brands and industry with a massive opportunity to enrich their community. And there's 14 million people with a disability in the UK, and it's about utilising that resource.
Yeah, I mean, any brand that's not taking account the kind of views of disabled people is missing, you know, a massive customer base and potential. So it's
great we're doing. And I think when I look at brands and businesses that have employment and are actually employed disabled people, they don't do it as a token now. They do it as, we want to empower a different community. And that's really important, that when you're delivering a resource to your community, you're wanting to have lived experience. And we all want that. We all want, when you're trying to promote healthy living, wellness and mental health, you want to see somebody that's had that lived experience to know that you can get through some of the challenges that we have at the moment.
Yeah. Are you happy to take some questions from the audience?
Yeah, sure.
If you've got a question, you want to put your hand up, we've got a roaming microphone that will come to you.
Hiya, how are you?
Hello. I just wondered, could you tell us more about your foundation and the work it does?
Awesome, yeah. So, again, so the in 2012, when I won and crossed that finish line, I wanted to really represent the disability community and have sustainability as well. And sustainability for me is to empower the leaders of tomorrow. So young people that haven't got the opportunities within sport, employment and education have an impact on them. And I remember as a young person at school, I didn't see teachers that looked like me or knew it was possible. So I want, with my foundation, to give those opportunities to young people. And so by having participation events, having impact on education and employment is really important. So we at the Whitehead Foundation want to be country leading in the work that we do. And the important thing with that is to make sure you reflect the community when you set up the foundation and charity. So we've got 60% of our trustees have a disability, 50%, a 50-50 split of gender, so male, female, and we're trying to represent all minorities within our trustee group. So like I said before about the intersectionality part of our organisation, we want to represent everybody so that when challenges come to the foundation, that we're able to help, guide and support. It's really important. I think what happens sometimes is if you don't fit into a box, then you don't get any support. And that's not what we're about. We're about supporting everybody and empowering everybody. And our big vision is to everybody within a disability deserves a platform, but we want to enable disabled people's ambitions because everybody deserves to have that opportunity. I hope that answers your question. And get involved.
The gentleman at the front, I think. Your question?
Yeah, hello.
Hi, young man.
First of all, actually, I think it's actually brilliant what you did and what you do. I got a minor impairment myself in my right foot, which transpired like 7 or 8 years ago. Talipes, minor form of club foot. Odd operation in 2019. The ankle stood a bit arthritic, so I'm a bit wobbly. But previous to that, I was quite active and also qualified as a fitness instructor and personal trainer. So I'm now looking to do level 4 strength and conditioning, and I want to get myself back to that point and set up a special needs fitness facility. Because I agree, we have got a long way to go. We've come a long way in 10 years, but we still got a long way because there's still a lot of bigots and stuff out there that see disability as a negative connotation to no ability. That's why I prefer the word impairment. So, yeah, so first of all, well done. That's sort of like my story. And I think it would be quite good if we can connect at some point
for sure.
To with the special needs fitness facility.
I think it's really important that we empower disabled people, and not just for the disability market as well. I think your skill set is obviously useful not only in the disability sector, but also to educate able-bodied people about what disabled people can and can't do. And that's what's really important, that we look at the skill set that we have and we empower this and give it a platform for success. So yes, the sport, the fitness industry, like I say, there's lots of issues within the physical and mental well-being sector. So keep doing what you're doing. It's really powerful, and it's also important to know that you've got a purpose as well. And whether you've got a disability or not, whether it's a minor disability or not, it shouldn't stop you from doing anything.
Any other questions? Otherwise, I've got plenty of questions.
Hi there. Hi. Can you hear me? Yeah. One of the first questions I've got is, when did you start using your prosthetic legs? Because obviously we've got a 7-year-old that don't want to be on them, but he does have them.
Yeah, that was me. That, so yeah, 18 months old, so I hired my first set of prosthetic limbs. They're a little bit different than they are now. If you, those that remember the old Douglas Bader kind of stories of tin and metal legs, that's the kind of prosthetics that I had. And prosthetics have obviously changed a massive amount in that time. There still is some problems and issues around the prosthetic provision, and that's one of the projects that actually I was working on with Nissan. On the Possibilities project, we had four young beneficiaries that couldn't have the running prosthetics that they needed to be more active. So we supported them in empowering them to be more active through prosthetics. And that would be a message to you and your family around, utilize the prosthetics as an opportunity to open your son and your son's world around what is possible. I as a young boy ran around on my stumps, on my knees, obviously like your child probably does, and that's amazing, and keep encouraging that. But it's about utilizing the technologies that's around to open up a new world, and here embrace that for sure. And I can speak on a lot of obviously amputees' parts, and there's a time when young people see the importance of technology and embrace that. And also, it's being different's good. I think embrace being different, educate the community around you. Obviously, come along in June to my event. It'd be great to see you after this as well. And I think young people, like I said before, are the leaders of tomorrow, and you and your family can make social change, so use that as a positive.
Definitely. Oh, I got one down there.
Hi, congratulations, although it's a while ago you'd had it, but congratulations still. Next year, because I'm starting year two of university, after returning after 15 years of basically being really ill, I'm now going to be the accessibility officer, and it'd really be good to get some of your experiences and advice and that. And I have a few other questions for you after this anyway, but
yeah. And I think it's really important to share those experiences and opportunities as well. And as a foundation, it's really important that we collaborate with other people and organisations for the greater good. Because we can't do everything in society, but we want to have an impact and a positive impact. And that's why the coming together of people at events such as this are really important. And also utilise this opportunity to communicate with people that you've maybe never spoke to before. And that is a real power of events such as this. Whether it's a running event, whether it's a social event such as this, a motability is a movement, right? And some of us struggle with movement. But movement is in different ways, and don't feel that just because your legs don't work that you're not able to be part of a real progressive movement, because you definitely can. And for me, it's really important that you embrace that opportunity and utilize, like you said, utilize education to empower not just yourself but also the community around you. And we definitely do that. Doing a lot of running today. You said you...
A bit quieter. You've mentioned education a lot. I'm interested, and I don't think it's a simple answer, I'm interested to know what your thoughts are on how we encourage people who are differently abled to get into working in education.
Yeah, well, obviously that starts at the real beginning of that journey for anybody, and whether that's in the teaching sector with the qualification of being a teacher, and encouraging more people to be part of that journey. I think it's really important not only to talk about inclusion and show the great benefits of that, but also the representation is really important. And then obviously with young people. So when we talk about having an experience with a person with a disability, it shouldn't be an assembly that somebody goes in to flash a medal. It should be an experience where young people can ask those questions those questions that maybe young people have, and whether that's about the disability itself or the possibility of for people with disabilities. And as we know, all disabilities aren't visible. There's lots of hidden disabilities as well. And whether that's physical, whether that's learning, sensory, all need to be represented. And from the start, it's really important that young people are able to have a voice around disability and have an experience, and not tokenism as well. I want us to have an experience where we have ambassadors go into schools and talk about how important the disability community is, where that disability community is in respect with all of us, and how we utilise that and communicate so that everybody's able to communicate on the same playing field as well. Because as we know, some of the communication issues that people with disabilities have aren't addressed, and we need to address those from school and educate young people to be more diverse in how we communicate.
Coming in thick and fast now.
Good morning, Richard. my daughter became disabled at the age of 9. She's gone to university and has a passion for trying to encourage schools to take on disabilities in every respect. When she went to her middle school, which happened to be on the Isle of Wight at the time, she was offered, well, in fact, she didn't do any sport, basically because the school felt she was too much of a risk. So I totally agree with what you're saying, but there's a long way to go to try and get schools to fully understand the implications of having a disabled person with it, or of any description, within the school. I think the footballer that's just come out at 17, fantastic. But he's one of how many ever are in the Premiership at the moment. It's so difficult.
And that's why we do what we do. We want to make that social change. Within the disability community, I hear a lot of it hasn't changed over the last 10 years, so it's not going to change over the next 10 years. But we need to make that social change. We need to get in at that starting position to start to educate teachers, people that employ those teachers as well, the importance of inclusion and how inclusion isn't just about disability, it's about everybody within that classroom. High learners, people with disabilities, it's about challenging everybody. And when I go into schools and we talk about going for gold or that goal setting, it's about challenging everybody and not just about those physical goals, but also those learning goals as well. And that's what's really important. So I definitely agree with you. We've got a long way to go with that. But we all need to start having that positive mindset about it. It is possible, but it's about having people within the disability community that are doers, that are proactive, and really believe. Because we as a foundation work on trust and honesty, and we honestly believe we can make that improvement, that difference. It's going to take a lot of people kind of coming with us on the journey, a lot of collaboration, but we do feel it is possible. The guy at the back, who I actually know.
Sorry, Rich, you know I can't say it, just not ask a question. I want to pick up on the education bit if I can. We've got more young disabled people and children in schools, in mainstream schools now, than we've ever had before. And I just wondered how the foundation will play a part in getting more awareness into schools about how we work with young people. I have the privilege of going into schools like you do and try and educate people, but it's a hard battle. And we've still got teachers in this day that don't get it.
Yeah, for sure. And it is about how you create that sustainable model as well, because you can't just go into school and have that impact that's going to last for years and years. You need to educate the families as well. It's really important to get the families on board and the communities around the young disabled people as well. And then offer opportunities within after school clubs, educate clubs and environments about the importance of inclusion and how that upskills the actual coaches, the team leaders, through being more inclusive. I remember a lot of people that have worked with me in the past, whether it's strength and conditioning coaches that have worked in the disability community, have said how empowering it is for them personally, because they're having to think outside the box, they're having to problem solve. You look at all the world leaders that are successful in the community, they've all had an impact on the disability community, whether that's autism, whether that's learning disability, whether that's physical disability. And that's what we need to think about. We need to think about how we're going to interact with young people, engage with these young people and give them the platform. It's really difficult because when you're an able-bodied person, how do you have that lived experience? That's the thing, it's educating able-bodied people that you need to have people with disabilities with lived experience to have that impact. Because I run on the track and you see that success, but when I come off the track, I don't leave my disability on the track. My disability comes with me. And hopefully people see me as Richard Whitehead, the person, not the athlete, because hopefully I give back more to society as a disabled person than I do as an athlete.
That's a brilliant place to end. Thank you so much. I think we've learned a lot from you.
Thank you. Thanks for your...
Am I right to think you're going to be on the Nissan stand for a little while today?
Yeah, we'll be around the Nissan stand.
That's
selling Leafs and Arias. And
that would be great. And for the viewers at home, here's a powered wheelchair and scooter demo with Jim Wood. So thanks again, Richard. It's been great to have you.